about, you know, where we're seeking to have impact and some of what we're doing in all of these areas of impact. So this is our stamp, and I'll get to that in more detail in a moment. You also see the display here. If I have a feeling that's why the podium is here. Let me first just give you an update on various aspects of our school, and then I'll delve into our vision. And I want to emphasize that this vision of Columbia Engineering for Humanity is a collective vision. It's not my vision. It's a vision from everyone at our school, where we feel we are as engineers at Columbia. So when we look at our school and we look at our student body, we are actually a pretty large school. I think when you think of an engineering school in the heart of an Ivy League university, some people might think, oh, it's a pretty smaller school. But it's actually a very powerful school. We have over 1,600 undergraduates and 2,600 graduate students. When we look at our entering class of students, people want to come to Columbia Engineering. Over 8,500 applications for an entering class of 320 students. 20% of our students are international. 49% of our engineering students in the entering class are women. So we're very proud of this. And really an incredibly talented student body. This is at Haffemeyer Hall, which is a classroom that holds about 330 people. It fits our first year class perfectly, so we welcome them on the first day with welcome talks by faculty, by students, by young alums. And it's just kind of fun, and we welcome them with this little room so everybody's waiting. Our success in attracting talent and attracting diverse talent has really caught the attention of many, including the Wall Street Journal, who noted that we seem to be doing something very special at Columbia to attract women into our programs, and we're quite proud of this. I want to say a few things about the students coming to Columbia Engineering from India. So when we look at our undergraduate student demographics, this is the entering class. So the class that entered in 2014 had six students coming from India. So you see, we typically have between 5 and 7. We had a banner year coming in this year of 12 students, and really incredible talent coming to Columbia Engineering undergraduate level from India. At our graduate population, we have both a Master of Science program. This is a program that prepares our students to go out professionally into the field of engineering. We have 354 students coming from India. This is showing that they're coming across all the different departments. Computer science, very popular, not just with Indian students, with American students, with students from all over the world. But we do have a great distribution across all departments, and also in our PhD program. Interestingly, so 12% of our graduate student population is coming from India, with 23% of that population being women. When we look at our alumni, so this is shows the alumni from across the globe. This is for Columbia overall. And when we look at the alumni coming from India, the greatest percentage of that Columbia alumni in India are coming from the School of Engineering. So we're trying to really foster a more robust alumni network as well. I want to say a few words about our faculty. We have been expanding our faculty, so growing our school. When I came in 4 years ago, we had a faculty of 172. We're now at close to 210 faculty. So over the past 4 years, we've hired 78 new faculty. So we've had some retirements, but we also have growth. So it's not just rejuvenation hiring, but also growing the school, expanding the school, because there's so much opportunity today as an engineer. So it's been a fantastic time to be dean, because you get to really think about where do we want to have strengths and how do we achieve those strengths in our school. We have incredible talent. This is just some of the awards received by our faculty in the last year. I'll point out a couple of them. Julia Hirschberg, she's the chair of our computer science department, was elected into the National Academy of Engineering this year. Gordana Bunyak-Novakovic was named a university professor. This is the highest academic honor at Columbia University. There's about one dozen out of the many thousands, actually, of faculty at Columbia. And this is the first time we had an engineering faculty named a university professor. There have been, I think, a total of something like 36 university professors in the history of Columbia. So this is a huge honor and recognition for engineering, and of course for Gordana. We have incredible young talent. The young talent received, our junior faculty received awards from the NSF called Career Awards. This is incredible recognition. Presidential Early Career Award, Young Investigator Awards from the Air Force and from DARPA. These are all recognitions that the young faculty that we're hiring are incredibly talented, achieving national recognition, as well as our senior faculty. Just 2 weeks ago, Don Goldfarb received one of the highest prizes from the Inform Society called the John von Neumann Theory Prize. So these are like the highest academic recognitions any faculty could be achieving. We've also, since we've been growing the school and we're hiring faculty, we hire both at the junior and the senior level. And that's a real opportunity. And just this July, we had two superstars in computer science join Columbia Engineering. As you may know, 5 years ago, we began a data science program called the Data Science Institute. That we started this in the School of Engineering under the leadership of Kathy McCune. So this has finished its first 5 years. And at this five-year junction, we realized that this is a field that has permeated every school at Columbia. If you're in policy, you need to know about data science. If you're in journalism, if you're in medicine, if you're in business. So we've, with President Bollinger's leadership, raised this to a university-level institute, and we attracted Jeanette Wing to leave her very instrumental job as VP of Microsoft Research to come to Columbia to lead this next phase of the Data Science Institute. Jeanette is known for computational thinking of how do you think of computer science permeating education in every field. So really a perfect vision for how do we really take this next stage in data science. We were also very fortunate to attract Professor Christos Papadimitriou. He is considered the world's leader in computational theory. Okay, the theories underlying computer science. He's a professor at Berkeley, and he recently joined us in July. He will be spending 2 weeks as the Infosys visiting professor here in India at the India Institute of Science in Bangalore at the end of December and beginning of January. So we do see many faculty doing individual engagements with different universities, different organizations in India. And it's wonderful to have a global center that can also facilitate even more of these. I want to talk a bit about our places. We have really, over the last 4 years, paid a lot of attention to how do we have world-class spaces, world-class classrooms, education laboratories, research laboratories. to match the talent that is in the student body and the faculty body at Columbia Engineering. So we have renovated more than one-third of our space since I've been dean, and these have included some of the things going on this year is the expansion of a nanofabrication and characterization facility, we'll be expanding our maker space, many student spaces. We have lots of different student engineering teams. We are also expanding our collaborations with the medical campus. We have engineering faculties and their students' research labs up at the medical campus. This enables greater collaboration of engineers with clinicians and medical researchers. So being right on the medical campus is amazing. And research labs across every department. You also will have learned that Columbia is expanding its campus. We have a new campus called Manhattanville, just a few blocks north of our Morningside campus. The first building opened, the Green Science Building, which is the home to the Zuckerman Mind Brain Behavior Institute. This is an incredible facility, and this is home to neuroscientists and engineers working in neuroscience. So we have faculty members from engineering who have now established their labs in the Zuckerman Mind Brain Behavior Institute. So the sense of how we are enabling and propelling very cross-disciplinary research, I think, is a real strength of Columbia Engineering. The a current renovation underway, especially for alumni in the room, will know that the campus entry to the engineering is our favorite mud building, which is down here. Right now, this is a wall of cement, and we are opening up our computer science department to really have a more visible presence on campus to really sort of advertise the incredible engineering school we have as people walk through our campus. We also have a great commitment to innovation and what we call translation, how we translate research and ideas into real-world practice. One of the things we're doing in our expansion up on the medical campus is that we are working with Alexandria Life Real Estate to create an incubator on the top floor of the building where we're expanding our biomedical research labs. So this will enable a very smooth and seamless translation of research that's happening in the labs to be now into an incubator to actually start a company and get that research into real world practice. I want to highlight now a bit about our vision. That always goes so fast. So we call this Columbia Engineering for Humanity, and I'll explain this stamp as we go on. So when I came in to Columbia, we did a lot of sampling of where do we have strengths, where do we want to have, where are we having impact, where do we aspire to have even greater impact. And what came back is this list over here on your left, right, that we realized all the work going across all departments in the areas related to sustainability. So on water, energy, food, climate, the environment, on areas related to health and wellness, to communications and information, to risk and security, and to creativity and innovation. When we were looking at this, we noticed the parallel to Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. As we think of what do we need to be fulfilled as a human being, that this is the pyramid, Maslow's pyramid, saying that we really need physiological safety, love and belonging, esteem, self-actualization, you know, our creativity, our ability to really be imaginative. And we can see that parallel. We thought this social science construct, especially being in an Ivy League school, was kind of a perfect marriage to our engineering school. And so we thought, how do we express that in terms of our engineering impact? And so when we think about where do we want to have impact with our engineering education and research, we think about in bringing our engineering impact to a sustainable humanity, engineering for a healthy humanity, for a secure humanity, a connected humanity. How we're connected to one another every day is through engineering now. And we're also now finding ourselves connected to the world around us, right? Autonomous vehicles, sensors everywhere, through engineering. And engineering for a creative humanity. Engineering is a creative profession, and engineering also enables creativity in other professions. So this is where we came to this tagline, if you will, of Columbia Engineering for Humanity. We converted that to its more circular framework because when we had our discussions on this, we said this really isn't a pyramid. This is an interconnected set of challenges. That if I do something to address air pollution in India, which seems to be a pretty big problem these days, you couldn't even get into Delhi, that I'm going to also impact human health. And you can go around and see the interconnection of all of these areas. And so this is, we felt, it's really just a beautiful way to, in one very succinct stamp, express our aspirations as engineers at Columbia. We also have a commitment to very foundational areas. Okay, the research that we do in some areas, we don't know exactly which field they'll have their impact, but these areas are going to bring the breakthrough solutions of tomorrow. So we all know how much is going on in data science, with machine learning and artificial intelligence, how we're increasing our ability to sense everything, right? And to image everything, to visualize, to model, to simulate, to create new materials, to actually design and build things from the nanoscale, from nanometers up to the macro scale. How many people know what a nanometer is? So think of your hair, okay? Your hair is about, the diameter is probably about 10 to 25 microns. Nanometer is 1/1000 of a micron. So the nanometer is pretty tiny. We can now design and build things from the nanometer to the macro scale. We can create all kinds of devices, and of course we know how robotics is really reshaping every area. So when we're doing research on these areas, sometimes it's very directly related to sustainability or health, where sometimes we'll come up with a new material and then find that that material's going to change how we can clean water. Okay, so we want that fundamental work because that also can bring solutions that we hadn't even dreamed of before. So this is a video to articulate our vision. Columbia Engineering for Humanity, it can feel a little abstract. So we the best way to really get this across is by illustrating what do we mean by that. This video gave you some sense of how we're bringing engineering to have that impact. And we've also started to put together a series of small stories, of vignettes that illustrate that. So I'm going to go through a few of them. First, let me just give you some overviews in some areas. So when we look at a healthy humanity, we see that we're doing work in so many different areas, from regenerative tissue engineering to imaging our brain, to bringing ultrasound to actually be a therapeutic device, to bring data science techniques to really understand how DNA analysis and genomics can actually give us information to change how we treat patients. I can go on and on to the list and how we're bringing engineering to actually impact health. Now I'm going to show you an example vignette. And I will read this to give you the sense where we have an aspiration, we identify a problem, and then we actually say, what are we doing at Columbia? So in Healthy Humanity is one example vignette. Imagine a world where we can look to our bodies for cures as singular as ourselves. Every person is unique, right down to their bones, making it difficult to restore precise form and function to the face and the body following disease, injury, aging, or trauma. So at Columbia, Professor Gordana Bunyak-Novakovic has pioneered a bioreactor that can use a patient's stem cells to generate personalized bone, tissues, and organs. This is something we're doing at Columbia, our students, working with our faculty, and in her lab, also working with clinicians and medical researchers. And that has also enabled the translation of this research, which is very fundamental research, which has now resulted in two startup labs, which is getting this work out into the real world. Another example from Healthy Humanity. Imagine a world where bacteria can help destroy cancer and make beautiful art. This sounds like conflicting elements, don't they? For years, society focused on killing bacteria. Now attention is turning to what this complex, invisible world can do. How can bacteria be our friend? Tal Danino puts his mastery, Tal is a professor in biomedical engineering, over bacteria to therapeutic and artistic ends. He can program bacteria to detect and treat cancer, and to at the same time create beautiful patterns shown in galleries around the world. If I go back to this slide, if you were to do a close-up of this artwork, you would see that what this artwork is bacteria. And he's programmed that bacteria to go and form those patterns. So he's using art to illustrate what can be done with engineering today. Okay, the objective wasn't to form the art. The objective was to show that we can tell bacteria where to go. We're doing so much in sustainability. I won't go through this list, but you know, whether we're looking at water, whether we're looking at air, at food, how do we bring engineering solutions to bear on some of the most dramatic challenges facing our planet today. So as an example, imagine a world with a reliable supply of water to meet the needs of agriculture, energy, industry, the environment, and communities everywhere. The high variability in renewable water supply, depleting groundwater stocks, and growing populations pose one of the most dramatic challenges of this century. Professor Manu Lal co-founded and directs the Columbia Water Center. His expertise in hydrology and water resourcing is really guiding work around the world. And I know he was at the Global Center maybe a couple of years ago presenting this, and we're talking again today about how we can bring his work and then those of other colleagues to India in a more direct manner. He has collaborated quite extensively across India on water resourcing. Another example on sustainable humanity, I won't read through this one, but there's huge issues in material waste from processing. And in Alyssa Park's lab, together with her students, she's tackled the very dirty problem, steel production. And we need steel to build our world. Yet producing steel has a huge source of greenhouse emissions and also of waste. The waste is called steel slag. So in Alyssa's lab, they've accelerated the carbonation of stainless steel slag for the production of value-added products. So having other materials come from that waste while capturing CO2 at the same time. In this, she has a pilot plant that is doing this process, and Baotou Steel in China is building a larger scale pilot plant in China. Security amenity. As I said, when we think of security amenity, we're talking about every form of security. We have faculty working on cybersecurity. We have faculty working on thinking about storm surge from, you know, from weather disruptions. So every kind of area of security, we find that we have research going on across our school. I'm going to give you an example on power grids. So imagine a world where power sources are reliable, secure, efficient, and environmentally friendly. So power grids, as we all know, are under incredible stress for the absolute need of power to power our lives, but they can be disrupted from the overextension, but also from different threats. This could be natural threats and, unfortunately, man-made threats. So we have faculty who are experts in operations research, Dan Beanstalk, working with electrical engineering experts such as Bill Zussman, using advanced computing techniques to find the vulnerability in complex power grids. These data-driven techniques, math analysis, and algorithmic tools help create a network that's more securable and that can recover from attack. So does it have the right redundancies in it? How does it recover from an attack? This same approach is enabling them to think about, now if I throw on renewable energy sources, which are sporadic, how do I still have a resilient and reliable grid? Connected humanity. So by connected humanity, how are we each connected to one another? Right? One of the first places your mind might go is thinking about social networks, all driven by engineering. This is how we connect with each other locally and globally. And there's many other we also need the hardware to have the software connections. I'm going to give you an example on a hardware issue. So imagine a world of fast and unlimited Wi-Fi anywhere on the map. So wireless devices require large magnetic materials to transmit and receive data at the same time, and a fact that has hindered Wi-Fi capacity in small handheld devices. In Professor Harish Krishnaswamy's group, they're the first to double Wi-Fi capacity on the chip level. So on a single chip, you can use the same strand, the same element to go back and forth. So this is immediate doubling of Wi-Fi capacity at the chip scale. Really an amazing feat. When we think of creative humanity, creativity exists in almost every aspect of engineering. We have faculty who are working together with chemistry faculty to form a new, what they call it, a new periodic table of nanomaterials. So this is going to enable a whole new way of designing and building materials that are very specific for certain functions. I can go on and on here, but I'm going to give you an example of how we're using engineering to enable creativity of others. So you probably saw in the clip, we had a Disney clip. So you might have wondered, what has that got to do with anything? So if we think about animation, and animation today is actually physics-based. And so the tools used to create these animated movies, particularly the Disney movies, are coming from the technologies and the physics-based simulation capabilities developed in the labs of Professor Eitan Rinspa at Columbia. So we like to refer that he's been discovered by Hollywood. His work in discrete differential geometry is expanding the ability of movie makers to portray reality based on the physical laws of nature. So that's why now when you see an animated movie, those movements look more real. And that's because they are actually capturing the physics of motion in them. And that's whether, you know, if you're tossing your hair or flouncing your skirt or, you know, running, they're capturing the real physics of motion. We also think of how we bring engineering to impact humanity in sort of cluster areas. So where do we have cluster areas which we're attacking collectively as groups of faculty? So we have quite a lot going on in thinking about how do we take our modern cities and make them smart? How do we make them more sustainable, more secure, more connected? So this brings together faculty from civil engineering, from electrical engineering, from computer science, from mechanical engineering, from earth and environmental engineering, to collectively attack these kinds of problems, to think about wastewater, to think about the electric grids, to think about distributed environment sensors. So how are we going to do these things all together to enable the city of tomorrow? We also have quite a lot going on in the world of fintech. And in particular, Professor Arun Iyengar, who's the chair of our industrial engineering operations research, is really collectively leading this effort of a number of faculty. As you may know, Columbia Engineering has the top undergraduate and graduate programs in financial engineering. And so this is one of the foundations of our fintech efforts. I'm going to give you one example from this. We're looking at fintech and its connection with really securing our financial future. So imagine a world where a deep understanding in the role of human behavior in financial markets could help prevent future bubbles and crashes. So because human beings participate in financial markets, human psychology and emotions play a role in how a market evolves. And this could be highly unpredictable. Professor Junyu Zhou is using math and statistics and data science to actually tackle this problem. He builds quantitative behavioral finance models that capture the human element in market behaviors. His work helps develop policies for smarter risk and wealth management while avoiding new errors and old errors. So we're very fortunate to attract Professor Zhou to come to Columbia about 2 years ago, where he was leading a financial institute at Oxford University. So he's established a new program in asset management within the School of Engineering. I want to say a few things about our programs and then open up for questions. So we do a lot, even beyond our curriculum, to really try to encourage the creativity and innovation in our students and our faculty. We hold design challenges, we bring our alumni together with our students, we do a lot in innovation and entrepreneurship. We really celebrate student creativity in a senior design expo where our seniors do capstone classes. So there are many elements that we bring together to really accelerate and propel our students. At the graduate level, one of the things we've recently done is introduced a professional development and leadership program. So this is we have graduate students coming to Columbia Engineering from around the world. And we are looking to not only shape their engineering expertise, but also to shape those other skill sets that are going to enable them to be successful in the future. And so we've introduced a set of workshops that cover everything from ethics and integrity to communication skills, written and speaking, because we think it's so important We want our students, and we're investing in our students, to be successful when they leave Columbia. And not just technically successful, but we want to really shape them in a way that enables them to be leaders. We have also been paying a lot of attention to how rapid the world is changing, how technology is really disrupting whole fields. And we're trying to reach out to broader communities. We've introduced some online education programs in some advanced topics in engineering. So one of the areas that we've been working on is a small set of courses, four courses, focused on very specific topics. These are referred to as MicroMasters degrees. They're like a certificate of four courses. They're online, they're on the edX platform. So we've launched the one in artificial intelligence. The classes are taught by Columbia faculty, and the four courses that form the artificial intelligence series, the foundation of artificial intelligence, machine learning, computer animation, and robotics. So this is online, it's free. If you want a certificate, it costs not much money. We have 100,000 students enrolled taking this course. So we would never be able to educate 100,000 students on campus at Columbia, but we can reach out and help propel more of the world in this field that is reshaping every profession. We're doing a lot in partnership with our other schools at Columbia. I've talked a bit about what we're doing with medicine, and one that I want to highlight is a partnership we have with the business school. As you know, we have a world-class business school, and this fall we'll be launching a joint degree program, Master of Science degree in Business Analytics. So how do we bring the rigor of analytics and algorithms that Columbia Engineering is known for together with the marketing and business expertise of our business school to produce the business leaders of tomorrow? So this will be a Master of Science degree launching this coming fall. And in addition to that, we are forming a MicroMasters in Business Analytics. I want to go over our Innovation and Entrepreneurship Programming. We offer a whole suite of different types of activities to propel innovation and entrepreneurship of our students and our faculty. From venture competitions and pitch competitions to design challenges to a co-working startup lab in Soho for young alumni to a living environment for undergraduates called ResInc. We've launched a makerspace, accelerators and boot camps, as well as a translational fellows program for postdocs and advanced graduate students. On the makerspace front, we have an extensive set of laboratories that we've always used in our curriculum. We've been very actively renovating these laboratories and at the same time introducing a makerspace that is a 24/7 facility that's not connected to any particular class or curriculum, that is a way to empower our students, our faculty, our researchers to be able to go in, create and make independently on their own or in small groups. We do a lot to accelerate research to impact. We have a network of accelerators that, through our Columbia Technology Ventures, CTV for short, helps us run. And some of these are actually in partnership with the City of New York and the State of New York. So whether it's in our research that's focused in the medical area, research focused in the energy area, for research focused on media. Of course, New York is the hub of media. There will also soon be emerging one focused on cybersecurity and one focused on augmented reality and virtual reality. If you were to look at the statistics of patenting and startups coming out of Columbia, it is just really incredible what's happening there every year. These are just some examples of startup labs coming out from our startup companies coming out of our research labs. I mentioned the tissue regeneration startups coming out of Gordana's lab. We have startups in the areas of cybersecurity coming out of computer science in Professor Stolfo's lab. We have startups in the area of genomics, how to do faster and cheaper sequencing. We talked about Alyssa Parks. I won't go on and on, but the list of what's coming out, how we translate our work to impact from our research labs. We also have an incredible, robust set of new companies coming up from our students. And these could be from student projects or from student extracurricular activities. I won't go through these. You can read through them, but it really is impressive to see that ideas that may germinate in a hands-on classroom, a project-based classroom, have actually resulted in companies, or have resulted from a design challenge that brought students together to address a pressing area. I'm going to give you one example of that. This came about from a design challenge that we launched on the Ebola crisis. When Western Africa was in the midst of this incredible tragic situation. So one of the areas that the School of Public Health highlighted to us was that the healthcare providers who were going in and treating patients with Ebola, they have to kind of totally suit themselves up. When they came out to rest, they had to decontaminate the suit before removing the suit. And what was being found was they were still catching the Ebola virus. And so they were not adequately decontaminating, because they couldn't see where the disinfectant was applied, and they couldn't tell also if it was applied long enough. So the student team, undergraduate students, made a proposal that they would be able to create a better disinfectant that you would be able to know if it was on the suit and if it was on the suit long enough before you disrobed. So they called their product Highlight, and it was a very simple idea where they had an additive that colored the bleach. Of course, when they presented this to faculty, they said, it's not going to work. Bleach is going to get rid of the color. But we said, well, let them try it. And so what happened was that what they added made the bleach sticky, so it stayed on the suit. And yes, the bleach got rid of the color, but it took 10 minutes. And that's how long it needed to stay on. So they could see where it was. It was on the suit long enough, and so it was effective. They got major funding from USAID. They did field tests in Liberia. They also now have venture funding of their company. So I think this is really quite a remarkable story. And Jason Kang is now the young investigator ambassador for the Lummelson Innovation Program. So in addition to, of course, his CEO role in the company Kinos. So I'm going to close there and say there's many ways to follow all the exciting things happening at Columbia Engineering. Of course, I can only give you a small snapshot. There's much more to learn and see. And so I invite you to follow us and